Hi, my name is Steve Gedeon. I'm on my third career. My first career was as an engineer. I have a PhD from MIT in engineering, 100 patents and reports and publications and things like that, mostly in the field of automation, industrial systems, mechatronics, control systems, artificial intelligence, stuff like that. I've worked with probably every Canadian company that you've heard of in the manufacturing field. So every oil and gas company, every pipeline company, every hydro company, every car company, every railroad building company, Bombardier. I was going to say every airplane company, but there's only one. Then I realized nobody cares about technology. Wow, for a guy who devoted his life, you're shaking your head. Like, you don't believe that. Nobody cares about technology. People care about what technology does for them. Nobody cares how the molecule works that cures cancer. They just care that cancer is cured. And so I abandoned my career in technology and started up a career as an entrepreneur and venture capitalist. So I've been CEO or founder of about 15 to 20 venture capital firms, for-profit, non-profit, public companies. The largest venture capital firm would have been a $100 million U.S. corporate VC program out of San Diego. The largest public company would have been publicly traded on the Toronto Stock Exchange, London Stock Exchange, NASDAQ, with 26 subsidiaries in 15 countries. Started up various nonprofit things. I'm one of the founders of the Digital Media Zone, for example. I named the Digital Media Zone, which is why it's the DMZ, not the DMZ. It was actually a joke. Maybe I shouldn't put that on tape. It's like the demilitarized zone between all the faculties to fight over. That was my joke. Now that I can come clean. Especially now that they renamed the Digital Media Zone the DMZ. I'm like, ha 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 ha. Made some money, got a cottage and all that kind of cool stuff, and a wonderful wife that I'm passionately in love with and loves me, and decided that to start a career with a little more work-life balance, and so became a professor. So I'm a professor of entrepreneurship here at Ryerson. It's the largest entrepreneurship program in Canada. We've got three MBA programs. We've got a major in entrepreneurship, a minor in entrepreneurship, a certificate in entrepreneurship. We've got entrepreneurship courses for non-business students. We now have, I think, 15 different zones here at Ryerson. We've got our own venture capital firm, our own angel network. It's a real happening place for entrepreneurship. So anyway, they asked me to talk about design thinking, and I changed the title to Lean Agile Design Thinking because I think the word or the term design thinking is a little bit overused. But before we talk about design thinking, I want to talk a little bit about entrepreneurship in general. For most people think about entrepreneurship as starting up a business. But for me, entrepreneurship is something far more fundamental than just starting up a business. It's really looking at what is and imagining what could be. It's having a different relationship with reality. Most people go through life kind of with blinders on. And their job of their brain is to filter out all the noise so they can focus on, I'm not sure what. I guess they're focusing on whatever's on their phone or they're focusing on whatever's in their head. But they tune the world out and they focus on what's in their own headspace. This is a disaster if you're entrepreneurial. You will absolutely fail if you believe your own BS. If you write your stupid business plan and like, my business plan is great, we're gonna get 1% of $1 billion, it's bound to be successful, you will fail. You have to be more in tune with reality than that. And a lot of people really aren't very much in tune with reality. I'll give you an example. I was teaching an MBA class. Maybe I shouldn't pick on the MBAs, but I was teaching an MBA class. And somebody said, oh, Professor Gedeon, I need some money. What can I do to get some money for my company? I said, you could apply to the business plan competition. They said, what business plan competition? I said, you're looking for money, right? Yes. Are you looking hard for money? Oh, yes. How come you don't know about the business plan competition here? Well, nobody told me about it. And I said, there's a poster on the door to this room. Well, I didn't see that. I said, there's a 6-foot round thing that you stepped on twice on the way from the elevator to here that says business plan competition. Even if you were looking at your foot, you would have seen that. I didn't see that. And I said, my guess is that there's at least 40 different posters between the door that you walked in on and this classroom saying win $50,000, win $25,000 for the business plan competition. And they all sat there and called me a liar. And so the whole class, I said, let's take a bet. We walked down the hallway, and there were 42 different posters that they walked by from the front door saying, your name here. Do you need money? There was a check that was 12 feet wide by 3 feet tall. Your name here, $25,000. Win money for your business. Didn't see it. You got to open up your eyes to the world around you. And that's something that you have to be able to do as an entrepreneur. So I'm telling you this because before we talk about design thinking, like design thinking is one tool among many in entrepreneurship. The second thing is not just seeing the world is what could be or seeing what is out there and imagining what could be, but knowing that I can make it happen. I can make it happen. Entrepreneurship is the most empowering, freedom-loving, creative force in the world because it says you don't need mommy and daddy to make you happy. You don't need the government to make you happy. You don't have to wait until Justin Trudeau makes your life better because he's the candy man throwing money at every special interest group that wants to get elected from him or whoever else is running for office. You don't have to wait for other people to make your life better. If you see an opportunity, you can do it. And you can do it as a student. You can do it as an older person. You can do it as a retired person. You can do it as a disabled person. You could do it as a person in China. You could do it as a person in Canada. You can do it, but that's kind of a mindset. You have to decide that you want to do this. Because a lot of people, you know, they just kind of want things to happen easily. But if it was easy, the Chinese would do it at 1/10 of the price of you. Or the Indians. Actually, nowadays, the Indians, or the Chinese aren't even doing stuff. They're outsourcing stuff to lower cost jurisdictions like Sri Lanka. Sorry, you're making $3 a month? You're too much money. I'm outsourcing you to the Sri Lankans. That's what's happening in China these days. So if it was easy, somebody else would do it at 1/10 of the price. You have to embrace the fact that it's hard. So entrepreneurship is something far more fundamental than a business skill. It's something that's fundamental to the human spirit. It's not just something that we teach in the Ted Rogers School of Management, but it's everywhere. It's pervasive. It's not just a business discipline. It's a different way of seeing, thinking, and acting. And this can be applied to four different domains. It can be applied to starting up a new business, of course, but can also be applied to being a better employee. You can be an entrepreneurial employee, or what we sometimes call intrapreneurship. And people are desperate for this. Employers are desperate. They say, Steve, just give me a student. Like, I don't even care what they know. Just give me a student who doesn't have to sit around waiting to be told what to do. Just give me somebody who, like, just grabs the ball and does stuff. Doesn't sit around waiting to be told what font size, how many words, you know, when the assignments are due. I want somebody who's just going to jump in and like make my life better. Just be part of my company and like contribute to things. A go-getter, a self-starter, they call them. That's being entrepreneurial. Can also apply to being a change maker or social entrepreneurship, making the world a better place. Could be a new political party. Could be a new system of justice. It could be a new genre of music. Or film or something like that. But it can also be applied to personal development. You can't change the world if you don't first change yourself. So this is a far more broad-based approach to entrepreneurship than just how do you start up a business. It kind of sort of starts with how do you be a better human being. Because if you don't have personal success, you can't have business success. I'll say that again. If you don't have personal success, you can't have business success. If you can't show up on time for a class, good luck running a business. If you can't show up on time for things, you're just a person who just can't make and keep commitments. Don't start up a business. Go work for somebody else. Make their lives miserable rather than your customers. So when we talk about how do you go about being entrepreneurial, there's three major categories of things. There's the head, there's knowledge. So that's stuff like various tools, you know, strengths, weaknesses, opportunity, threats, matrix, which I think is one of the most useless tools I've ever heard of in my entire life. I've actually never in my life ever seen a SWOT that was worth the paper it was written on. But I figured you've all have heard of SWOT, so I put it up there. Porter's five forces, competitor analysis, financial analysis. There's all these tools that you need to know how to do. And there's various entrepreneurial knowledge like methods, like design thinking is a method. So I'm going to teach you about design thinking tonight. It's just one method. There's thousands of other methods. There's this great book by Bill Ouellette from MIT. A friend of mine wrote a book called Disciplined Entrepreneurship. It's a great book. I'm not going to teach you that tonight. So design thinking isn't everything. It's one of, I think we use seven of these methods in my entrepreneurship class. And that's one of our seven methods. That's what I'm going to teach you tonight. Second thing is the hand, skills. And I've listed a couple of skills here, like alertness and opportunity identification, creativity. That's that being aware of the world around you to spot new opportunities. But also bootstrapping, you know, guerrilla skills, the ability to raise money, the ability to get other people to do what you want them to do even though you're not paying them, the ability to make stuff happen even when you don't have a lot of money. This is a core entrepreneurship skill, the ability to get stuff done when you don't have a big bank account. It's a really important skill. I'm not going to teach you that. Persuading and selling is an important entrepreneurial skill. Agility, the ability to be fast, the ability to be nimble, the ability to make mistakes, learn from them, and change is a key entrepreneurial ability. I'm going to talk about that a lot tonight. Self-management, goal setting, again, you know, if you can't manage yourself, you can't manage other people. So that's an important entrepreneurial skill. Then, of course, there's the heart. There's attitudes. The belief, the attitude of being proactive as opposed to, well, you know, I don't want to go talk to customers. It's a lot of work to talk to customers. I want to sit behind my computer and just talk to Google. And hopefully Google will give me everything I need to know because I actually don't want to talk to customers. Or like something needs to happen, but you're not like running around making those things happen. That's a real key attitude to be a successful entrepreneur. Things like independence, internal locus of control, self-efficacy, grit, tenacity, these kinds of things are all key entrepreneurial attitudes. But what I'm going to talk about tonight is design thinking. Any questions about that so far? You okay? You look so crushingly bored. I'm going to do something just for you because you look so bored. I'm going to make your life better right now. So here's something a little more interesting. We're going to do the marshmallow challenge. So here's the rules. You're going to get 20 sticks of spaghetti, 1 yard of tape, 1 yard of string, 1 marshmallow. All of your supplies are sitting right over there. So we got a pile of spaghetti and string and everything. Break into groups of whatever you want. I'd say groups of 4 or 5 around your tables here. The rules are simple. Build the tallest freestanding structure. The entire marshmallow must be on top. Use as much or little of the kit as you want. You're free to break up the spaghetti string. Do not eat the marshmallow. I mean, you can, but I think the marshmallow is about 3 months old. Did you use the old ones or the new ones? Oh, good. Don't eat the marshmallows. They're at least 3 months old. You're free to break things up. We've got some scissors if you need it. The challenge lasts 18 minutes, and it begins right now. So I will note that we are currently halfway through, and nobody has bothered actually putting the marshmallow on top of anything yet. Construct their first thing. Nobody actually knows how much a marshmallow weighs so far. Oh, this team is overhearing me now. They're gonna try it now. So here we are at minute 15, and the first team out of 12 has actually put a marshmallow on top of something to see if it stands. First lesson that comes out of this thing. The first lesson is that prototyping and iteration beats planning every time. Prototyping and iteration beats planning every time. Oh my God, don't we teach a course here at Ryerson called How to Write a Business Plan? Yeah, not anymore, we don't. we used to teach that class. We don't teach that. Well, we still teach it for some people, but we took it out of the ENT degree program at least. So here's the typical progress. Here's what happens. You know, you get started, you got 18 minutes, you orient yourselves, you make some plans, you talk about it a little bit, you start building things, And so around about 18 minutes, it's done. We decided it was going to be this structure here. 18 minutes, it's done. But then what happens? Uh-oh. But guess what? You've now taken the entire amount of time to learn that you built absolutely nothing at all. And you've run out of money, you've run out of resources, your employees have all left you, you're bankrupt, and you haven't even built the first one yet. Because the first one you built failed. Kind of scary thought. That if you plan for something, like you guys were great over here. When I first saw that kind of crazy concoction, I thought, this is brilliant. I've got 3 engineering degrees. I never thought of that one before. But about 10 minutes in, it was clear it wasn't going to work, huh? Right? Within 12 minutes, like, you guys don't stand a chance of this thing working. But you kept at it. Because that's what you do. You keep at stuff, right? You were taught persistence, persistence, persistence. Even when you know it's going to fail, you keep on beating your head against that wall. So, I screwed up on this one. So who, now that I showed you, who performs poorly at this stuff usually?
The people on the next slide.
What's that?
The people on your next slide.
Yeah, the people on the next slide. You didn't see what it was, though. So who usually performs really badly at this test?
Business school students.
Yeah, exactly. I was supposed to do, a transition or an animation thing, so oops. Recent business school grads usually do really poor at this. Who usually does really well at this?
Children.
Yeah, little kids, recent kindergarten school graduates. So there's a variety of reasons for this. One reason is that, first of all, little kids don't plan. Little kids don't have a clue how this is going to work. So they build a little one, they see how it works, then they build a bigger one, then they build a bigger one. The other thing little kids do is they're walking around looking, what are you doing over here? What are you doing over here? There's only one person in this room I saw do it. It was you. You're the only person I saw. Every once in a while, like, what are they doing over there? I don't think you learned a lot from them, but at least you're one of the few people. Did anybody go online to look this up? That wasn't against the rules. You see, kindergartners don't know what's against the rules. Well, if they've got access to Wi-Fi or something like that. You could have potentially looked up what other people have done. I mean, it's called the Marshmallow Challenge. Type in the Marshmallow Challenge. And you can see some good examples and some bad examples and stuff like that. You can learn from each other. The big reason, though, that we've discovered is because kids prototype. They're not so arrogant as to think, well, I'm going to make it this big. And like from within 3 minutes, you guys were shooting for that height. Like, you knew how tall it was going to be within the first 3 minutes, I thought. Or maybe it was somebody else. So like, we're going to make it this tall, and like, nobody's going to convince us that it's going to be a different height. We're going to keep on playing at it until, what did I say to you, to the camera lady there? I think it was minute 15 before the first team actually put a marshmallow on top of a spaghetti and found out how heavy a piece of marshmallow was to see, you know, whether this thing would be stable or not. Kindergartners don't know that. They build a little one in the first 2 minutes, and they walk around like, oh, how big? Oh, you built a bigger one. Hey, we could build a little bit bigger. You want to try some more? Yeah, sure, why not? Let's build a second one, see if it's any bigger than that. Business students don't do that. They tend to, you know, have this, I've got 18 minutes, I'm going to plan for 18 minutes, and I'm going to, you know, design my thing. Some people were drawing things. I think you guys were writing stuff down. We're going to do this, we're going to do this. I'm like, ha, 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 ha. Yeah, that's because you know the modulus of elasticity of your average stick of spaghetti. You're like, aha, I'm calculating, I know my E. See, it's my engineering degree's kicking in. Prototyping and iteration matter. Prototyping and iteration matter. The second big lesson that comes out of this is that diverse skills matter. Here's another one that probably should be transitioned in. If the average is 20 inches, I'm not sure if anybody here did 20 inches. I think you were 42 centimeters. It's just short of 20 inches. Ouch. But hey, we're full of, you know, Ryerson University students. That's true. Actually, you did better than the average business student. Good point. Kindergartners tend to do really well. Architects and engineers better do well. Like, this is their job to do this kind of stuff well. But we learned that diverse skill sets matter. So, for example, CEOs don't do as well as CEOs with some of their admin assistants. And what we've learned is this idea of T-shaped profile people that have deep expertise in something, but broad facilitation skills. Yes, you're really good at something, but you're not such a jerk that you can't get along with other people. And we know that diversity matters. We know that if you take any group of guys and add a woman to it, performance goes up. We know that for a fact. Don't get too cocky, ladies. Yeah, take any group of women and you add a guy and performance goes up as well, too. But, you know, again, you know, you add a group of, you know, middle-aged white guys and you add somebody with a different ethnic background, performance usually goes up. Diversity matters. More than just diversity, it's diversity of skills that matter, though. So that's an important thing. So, you know, we used to teach business planning all the time. I mean, you know, for the last 30 years, every university in the country, every university in North America taught a class called How to Write a Business Plan. And what we've discovered is basically business plans don't work. Business plans only work when you know what your business is. But for most people, you don't know what your business is. You have to discover what your business should be. And only once you discover what your business should be, then you can spend your time putting words on paper. Until then, you shouldn't waste your time doing that. And this is this revolutionary new mindset that design thinking comes out of. So I haven't really talked about design thinking yet, right? I'm just talking about entrepreneurship still. But entrepreneurship, but design thinking really plays into this idea that learn something, build something, prototype it, learn, and then go back and do it over again. This whole idea of iterations. And the more times you iterate in the shortest amount of time, the more successful you are. And this is a revolutionary new thing. It's embodied in books like a good book would be Getting to Plan B. Whatever your plan is, A is, half of it's brilliant, half of it sucks. Problem is you don't know which half is which and neither do I. How fast can you learn how to get to plan B or C or D or E or F or G before plan G becomes successful? Let me give you some examples of this. Steve Jobs, one of the greatest entrepreneurs in our lifetime. A god of entrepreneurial creativity, and you can't get any better than Steve Jobs, right? The iPad, wow, brilliant. Does anyone remember the Newton? Yeah, you remember the Newton? Worst product in human history. The Newton sucked. And yes, the almighty Steve Jobs made the Newton and lost a gazillion dollars over it. Steve Jobs was such a lousy CEO, they fired him. And he started his next company. Anybody remember what the next company was?
Next.
It sucked too. Apple was such a lousy company that the US government went to Microsoft and said, if you don't give Apple $200 million to keep that crappy little stupid company on life support, we're gonna crush you under the boot heels of the US government and break you into 100 little Microsofts. Just like we did Standard Oil back in the day and Alcoa and all these other, you know, trusts they called them, right? They went to Microsoft and they said, we're gonna break you into 100 little companies if you don't keep that lousy company on life support. He looks like Steve Jobs, I'm pointing at him. And now suddenly it's like, oh my God, Steve Jobs, you're so brilliant. Well, yeah, you've been doing it for 30 years. You're bound to get it right eventually. Kind of humbling that even, you know, somebody as amazing as Steve Jobs got it wrong over and over and over and over again. Or Windows. I mean, we all, you know, does anybody remember Windows 1.0? It was a horrible product. People stuck with DOS. Who remembers DOS? The command line interface? Like, nobody would use DOS if you've got an alternative, right? But Windows 1 was so bad, people kept using DOS. And this was Microsoft. This is a multi-billion dollar organization that had like a 95% market share of the operating system market. So they came up with Windows 2. Nobody used Windows 2. Windows 2 was even worse than Windows 1. Windows 3, oh my God, you were an idiot if you used Windows 3. It wasn't until Windows 3.1 that Microsoft finally got it right and everybody converted from DOS over to Windows 3.1. And what are we on, version 10 now of the operating system? Half of them have sucked, right? Windows, there was Windows ME, there was Windows 98, there was Windows 2K, there was Windows XP, there was like only a handful of those were actually good products. A lot of the Microsoft, and this is Microsoft! They're good at this. They put billions of dollars and thousands of people into it and they still make lousy products. Linux coming around, it was better and it was made for free. A free product made by random people that didn't even know each other made a better product than Windows with the Linux shell. Wow, this stuff is hard. So the thought that you're going to make a product and it's gonna be good the first time around, you have almost no probability of making your product right the first time around. You have almost no chance of doing that. But that's okay, because if you could do it the first time around, so can the Chinese. Sorry to pick on the Chinese, but they're just a good example of a low-cost area with a lot of smart people that can do stuff. And so, you know, don't be so cocky about it. We're in Canada, we're smarter than the people on the other side of the planet. You know, maybe I'll pick on India instead. You know, they speak English, right? India will graduate more people this year who got nothing besides an A+ since the day they were born than we will graduate people. I'll say that again. India will graduate more students this year who have gotten A+ since the day they were born than we will graduate people from all of Canada combined. And they all speak English. They've all discovered the internet. They use the same textbooks you do. Their professors are pretty good too. So if you're not doing something different, something more iterative, something more learning, like if you can build it right the first time, so can they, because they're clever too. And this is one of the big new changes of entrepreneurship, is this idea of iterations, that it's gonna take one, two, three times. I'm gonna give you another example, just because I wanna pound this idea into you. Homesteaders in California. Homesteaders in California. So this was, you know, the wild, wild west. People, you know, travel across the country and they move to California to make a new lives for themselves. And the first people get to California and they say, wow, look at this beautiful piece of land. I'm living in paradise. I'm gonna build a house here and a fence and I'm gonna have cattle. And it didn't work. Cattle all die, they go bankrupt, they move on. A few years later, some other family comes by, they're like, wow, look at this beautiful piece of land. There's a house. How cool is that? There's a fence already built. I'm gonna have sheep here, and I'm gonna dig a well and build an outhouse. And the sheep all die, doesn't work out, they move on. Total failure, bankruptcy. Third family would come by. Wow, look at this beautiful piece of land. There's a house here, there's an outhouse, there's a well. The trees have grown to nice big tall trees. We've got a fence. Wow, I'm gonna grow, orange trees or something. And the third family would make a success of it. A huge percentage of the successful people in California were on that piece of land for the third time, and the first two failed. So part of the lesson of this is, how do you stay alive long enough to get to version 3 of your product? How do you stay alive enough to get to version 3 of your product? Because if you think you've got 18 minutes to get to version 3, right? Instead, you're spending your entire 18 minutes getting to version 1, which fell down, then we've got 7 teams out of 10 all went bankrupt and ran out of money before you actually built the first product that was possible to even stand up. So that's the big lesson that comes out of the Marshmallow Challenge, is you know, how do you get to version 3 or 4 before your time runs out, before your money runs out, before your spouse says, go get a job, before your kids say, look, Daddy, why don't you ever come home at night? Before your employees are sick of not getting paid, before your customers are sick of getting crappy products that don't work. Like, you gotta stay alive long enough to make that happen. So the big thing is about search and discovery of your business model as opposed to planning and execution of a known business model. And this is the big thing. So where does design thinking come in? My God, Professor Gideon, we've been here for almost an hour. You still haven't told us what design thinking is. So here's kind of sort of the lie that we talk about the entrepreneurship process. You spot an opportunity. Oh, it's a great opportunity. Don't tell anybody what your idea is. They might steal it from you. Don't believe them. Tell everybody about your opportunity. Tell everybody, spread the word. Get feedback on your opportunity. Next thing, write a business plan. But again, half your business plan sucks. Half of it's brilliant. You just don't know which half is which, and neither do we. Get a bunch of stuff, you know, and then you either succeed or failure. That's the lie. What we've learned is it's a lot more complicated than that. You know, you spot an opportunity, you talk to people, you start over again. You design a business model, you start over again. You do a little bit of this, you go back again. So success isn't this straight linear thing. Think of Steve Jobs, right? He had to get fired and come back. He had to make the Newton before he could make the iPad. Success is a lot more complicated than we want to believe. But that's good, because again, if it was easy, somebody else would do it at 1/10 of the price of us here in Canada. So you have to embrace the fact that this is really hard to do. So the first thing we did is we stuck this new thing in here called designing the business model. So who's heard of this business model canvas thing? Osterwalder's book, the business, so few people. Wow, okay, so, well, this is worth the price of admission right here. Osterwalder, O-S-T-E-R-W-A-L-D-E-R, wrote a book called Business Model Generation, where he talks about the business model canvas. The first chapter is free online if you type in business model canvas. And there's so many people that talk so much about it, you can probably get 80% of the book online for free. It's a cheap book. It's $22 or $25 or something like that. But his idea was, how do you get an entire business plan on one page? Like, don't waste your time writing a plan. Like, just get it all out on one page first. So this is kind of like a rapid prototype of the business plan. But the problem is, of course, is you get this iterative thing. So, you know, you take a step forward and two steps back, a step forward and two steps back. Design thinking is a tool or a methodology that comes very much in the early stages. Design thinking is this qualitative, developing empathy with your customers, really getting deep exposure to what their needs are, using an open beginner's mind to try to figure out what your customers want. It's kind of squishy, it's kind of creative, it's, you know, that kind of methodology. Lean startup, how many people have heard of lean startup here? Couple people. More people have heard of Lean Startup. Interesting. So Lean Startup, again, you could get 90% of this free from YouTube. Type in Steve Blank Lean Startup or Eric Ries, R-I-E-S. Eric, R-I-E-S, and Lean Startup. And, you know, spend a half an hour watching a YouTube video, and you'll get a lot of the core ideas of this stuff. Worth the book. I'd probably buy the Ries book rather than the Steve Blank book. Lean Startup is all about quantitative analysis once you've released your minimum viable product. So design thinking is kind of qualitative, happens in the early stages. Lean Startup is quantitative. How do you learn you release something out in the wild and you get some quantitative numbers, you do some A-B testing, and you use that to figure out, do you go with A or do you go with B, for example? Or you have a hypothesis. You say, I think people will, if we offer them something at a certain price point, that they'll click through to our website. And then you just do the test and you find out, like, how many people actually do that thing. It's a nice quantitative experimentation type of methodology. There's a bunch of other tools as well, too. There's all your standard strategy tools that we teach at Ryerson. There's the Hot or Not, Sean Wise's book that we teach in ENT 601. There's Discipline Entrepreneurship, which is the MIT book. There's competitor analysis and all this stuff. There's all these skills. There's a lot coming on here that I'm not going to talk about. I'm going to talk about design thinking. So among these agile methods, design thinking is more qualitative. Lean Startup is more quantitative. So the next thing I want to talk about, and I'm going to give you an example of, is the idea that stability comes from speed. Stability comes from speed. And in that way, a small company is kind of like a motorcycle. You know, when you got one of these motorcycles and you're moving slowly, everything is hard. Everything is hard when you're trying to move one of these 200-pound things. You know, the bike's here and I want it to be there. Oh, God. This is so hard. If there's a little rock. And you get it over the little rock. But if you're going 150 kilometers an hour on this thing, these wheels turn into gyroscopes. And now, little rocks, you don't even notice those little rocks. Competitor jumps to the road out in front of you, you're around that competitor like that. Or you run right over the competitor. Small animals, bushes, doesn't matter. Like, nothing stands in your way when you're on one of these things. Little rock, screw that. There's a mountain in the distance. A half an hour from now, I'm going to be on the other side of that mountain. And whole mountains come and go when you're still having fun. Everything is easy when you're moving fast. Everything is hard when you're moving slow. You're starting up a new business. Customers won't talk to me. I'm working on my business plan, but nobody will give me money. Nobody wants to join my team. They won't let me into the digital media zone. Well, of course not, because you haven't done anything yet. But as soon as you're doing stuff, people love you. When you're doing stuff, people are like, oh, wow. You know, you talked to me yesterday and gave me an example. I didn't want to buy it then, but you came back the next day and gave me a better example. And you came back 2 days later and gave me a better example. You came back 4 days later and gave me another example. I'm just going to buy your product. Wow. You've basically made four sets of slides and sold a product. Where somebody else might be like, oh, I'm still trying to look for a developer to build my app. Screw hiring a developer to build your app. Like, sell slideware. You guys have heard of slideware before? So you know what hardware is, right? Like, hardware is something you can touch. Software, it's kind of sort of inside. You know, slideware is, it doesn't even exist at all. It exists in your head. It's a PowerPoint presentation. Like, you don't, why would you waste your time creating a new app when you can have a set of JPEGs and say, you know, hey, let me show you my new app. It's just an image. When you click on that button, flip, it does this. And when you click on that button, flip, it does this. And I can show everything you need to know about my app on a series of JPEG images. I don't even have to do that. I can have a whiteboard, and I can have a little piece of cardboard that I can like draw what my app looks like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And like, first here I am. This is pretending this is my iPhone, right? I click on that button, move to the next one. You don't need to hire a developer. And you can make sales with this stuff. Or you can at least get feedback with this stuff and then move on and get more feedback and get more feedback. But if you're moving, people want to work with you. If you're moving and things are happening, then people want to be part of your great adventure. Otherwise, it's like, oh my God, the number of student teams I have are like, yeah, we're working on a new business, but you know, I'm in week 7 in a 13-week semester and we haven't figured out, you know, I don't know, you know, we're still trying to get our first meeting. You've been waiting for a meeting for 7 weeks? Oh my God, how many other people have you contacted? Well, we wanted to talk to the first one first. Yeah, but the first one hasn't talked to you. So what have you actually done for 7 weeks? Well, we haven't. Well, I went to Google. I did some, it's a multi-bazillion dollar market. We haven't done anything. And time marches on, and pretty soon your 18 minutes is over. You know, you've been planning, but nothing's actually happened. Like, get out there and do something. So that's a big thing with this idea of design thinking. So here's design thinking. So first of all, there's three elements of it. The first one is there's a variety of methods. The Hasso-Plattner Institute. Hasso-Plattner was the name of the CEO of SAP, based out of Potsdam, just outside of Berlin. They're kind of the big, you know, organization that's done a lot of work in this thing. Some of the most work out from a practitioner thing came out of a company called IDEO and David Kelly. David Kelly and IDEO did a lot of the original design work for the Macintosh. So Steve Jobs would say, for example, I need a mouse. It's got to have one button. Go figure it out. And they'd figure out, well, how big should it be? They'd figure out, you know, if you move 3 inches, how far should it move on the screen? How long should the plug be? What color should it be? Should it have kind of a squishy feel, or should it have kind of a more of a solid feel? Should it be a rubber ball or a metal ball or a wooden ball? And they figured out all those kind of design things. And they developed this methodology kind of based out of industrial design. So the Hasso-Plattner Institute out of Germany did most of the original important work. The Stanford Design School, and we're going to do a Stanford Design School stuff, based their methodology on the Hasso-Plattner Institute. There's some other big ones. I do a lot of stuff with the Strachik Center based out of Munich. St. Gallen out of Switzerland is another big one. Reggio out of Italy. You notice almost all this stuff is coming out of Europe rather than out of North America, which is one reason why we haven't heard about it a lot. So there's a method, and I'm going to show you a method, although there's other methods. I mentioned this whole multidisciplinary thing mattered, this T-shaped profile, that you want to get multidisciplinary teams of people, deep domain expertise in something, but broad skills. You know, no jerks in the room, please, because it kind of destroys team cohesion. The other thing that's important is this idea of a creative space, like we have here, which is one reason why we're doing this in this environment here, is that they found out that a creative environment, like a studio, you've all heard of like a design studio, it actually makes a big difference. Having big windows, tall spaces, lots of light and coffee and stuff like that makes a big difference. And here's why. It's really all about visualizing and recombining information. So this is an example here. This is a team that we did a week-long design thinking course here at the Digital Media Zone last year. What you do is that what this method lets you do, and I haven't told you what the method is yet, but you're acquiring information. So let's say you're in a team of 5 people and you each talk to 10 different customers. How do you share those 50 data points? And the temptation of most business students or most engineers is you write everything down on a piece of paper, you sit around a table, I tell you what my 10 things were, you tell me what your 10 things were, but there's no way to like really share that information.
What design thinking does is it gets you to, doesn't do anything. You use post-it notes, you use size of the post-it notes, you use color of the post-it notes, you use location of the post-it notes, and all of this stuff helps you to remember things. So you can imagine that sharing customer feedback from 50 different people in this kind of an environment is far superior to, well, I typed it all out on my computer and now I'm going to send you an email with my observations of 10 people. Now we're looking at 10 different Word documents and trying to compare all these Word documents, and you just can't do it. So it's a creative way to visualize and recombine information is one of the big things of this whole design thinking methodology. So here's an example of one of them. This is the Hasselplattner Institute as used by the Stanford D School. It starts by understanding what the problem space is, who are the stakeholders, kind of becoming a bit of a mini expert. Then you go out and you use this beginner's mind to observe the world and try to figure out what's going on. This is divergent thinking. You then define who your target person is. You synthesize that information. I'm going to go through this in more detail. Now you can start coming up with ideas. So this is the first interesting thing. Usually the big lie of entrepreneurship is it says it starts with an idea. What design thinking says is it doesn't start with an idea. It starts with talking to customers, finding out what their needs are, defining, my friend Jackie is 20 years old, he really likes anime, he really has this problem with dating, and what he really needs is he's got a problem around this thing. Now we can come up with ideas for that particular person. Rather than like, I'm going to come up with a dating website. Really, who's going to want your dating site? I don't know, people. What kind of people? Guys between 15 and 50. And we know that doesn't work very well. What design thinking does, it says, I want you to have that customer in your mind. And you're designing one product for one guy. You're my customer. I'm going to build something that you love. Hopefully, if you love it, there's other people kind of like you. But the hell with all them. We only care about you. We've defined you are the guy we're building our product for. And we have pictures of them up in our studio. And we're like, oh man, Daniel's going to love this thing. Daniel's going to rock this one out. He's going to throw money at us. He's going to be so great. He's going to love this thing. Hopefully there's more people like him. But that's different than saying, well, I'm selling to all guys between the ages of 15 and 55. Because maybe we're not so similar as you might think we are. We might have wildly different tastes in pretty much everything. So come up with your ideas, then you prototype it, you test it, and then you go back. So this is the kind of sort of the first cutter to design thinking thing. So first question often comes by, how long should this take to get from here to here? And the answer is we can do it in 1 hour. So you don't have to wait a month or a week or a year or something to get to your first prototype. You can actually do it in an hour because it's speed of iteration that's important. So that's what we're going to do right now. We're going to do, this is called the paper wallet exercise. This is, I stole this from the Stanford D School. There's a pile of paper right back over there. Each person gets one of those. Could you stand up and grab that pile of paper there? That's it right there. Yeah, if you could give everybody one or pass them around so everybody can get one. Everybody needs a pen, and you're going to break into pairs of two. So we're going through the paper wallet exercise. This is from the Stanford D School. Not sure if you can see that. So everyone's got their own thing. They broke into pairs. It's basically a 1 hour go through the whole design thinking process. And what you learn is that it works. And that in 1 hour, you can come up with something better than you might have been able to do on your own by going through this process. And then we're going to go back to the PowerPoint slides and talk about how to use this in a real example, taking full advantage of the whole ability to recombine information. So if you're online or you're not doing this now, I'm sorry if you're bored, but you can download this off of the Stanford D School website. Just type in Stanford D School paper wallet exercise. Okay, if you could turn to your first page, everybody's got their partner. The first thing you're gonna do on your own, and you have 3 minutes to design the ideal wallet. So just on your own, backside of the first page, you got a spot right here. spend 3 minutes, design the ideal wallet. Moving on. We're going to move on to flip the page to the next one. You got the two things here. So now what we're going to do is we're going to start by interview your partner. So forget about what you thought was the perfect wallet. You want to first interview your partner. So the first thing you want to do is interview each other. You've got 4 minutes. We're going to do 4 minutes interviewing your partner, then you'll interview the other person. Okay, we're moving on to box number two now. So we're going to do that interview again, but try harder this time to develop a better empathetic connection with the person. What really is important to this person? It's not just a wallet, but the wallet signifies something about who they are in their lives. Okay, person two is going to interview person one now. So switch interviewees. We're gonna move on to number three, so flip the page. Now you're gonna do this on your own. So fill in something under both areas here. So what do you think your partner's trying to achieve? And be sure to use verbs. Like, are they just trying to organize their lives? Or are they trying to make a statement about prestige? Are they trying to get laid? Like, what's going on with this wall? What else are they trying to achieve with this wallet? You want to use verbs. And then secondly, what might have surprised you that you wouldn't have thought of the first time? What insight might you have gained that you wouldn't have thought of otherwise? Okay, we're moving on to number four. We're now going to do what's called a point of view, which is, you can follow the thing here. Jessica needs a way to carry all of her stuff around with her, but surprisingly, she needs a way to bring a spare pair of underwear with her because she frequently gets caught at a friend's house for the night or something like that. Okay, we're moving on to number five. Now you can start coming up with an idea. Finally, you can have an idea for a new wallet. But don't come up with one idea. I want to see at least five radically different ideas. Okay, we're moving on to number six. So you've got 5 minutes each. So person A, share your five sketches or your 10 sketches with person B. Don't try to sell them on anything. You're just trying to get feedback. Okay, we're moving on to number seven now. On your own, you got 3 minutes to sketch your big idea. Okay, we're moving on to step eight. Build your solution. So we've got a pile of stuff right over there where the Lego blocks are. We got a pile of different colored papers. We've got pens, we got glue sticks, we got rubber bands. We've got construction materials. You can use anything you can find that isn't nailed down. So build your actual prototype in real life. Okay, moving on to number nine, the final phase. You have 4 minutes each to interview each other one last time, share your solution, and get feedback. Okay, Well, who came up with a better wallet at the end of this exercise than you started with in the first one? Raise your hands. Who came? Very good. Who came? You didn't. You did too. Okay, okay. Who came up with something that surprised them once they started talking to somebody else and they got out of their own head? So a couple of things to go through. One is that the end product of 1 hour talking to other people is almost always superior to what you start with when you're only in your own headspace. That's the first thing. You often uncover something that surprised you, and if you hadn't gotten out and talked to the other person, you would have never gotten that surprise. The other thing we learn is that you come up with a wide array of different ideas before you come up with the final idea. So let me kind of go through this thing here. So we started by saying, well, just talk to your partner. Just observe them, get some information from them. And then we wanted to synthesize that into what's really our challenge. Well, our challenge is, you know, I don't know, Daniel needs an electronic device that is, you know, I don't know, does whatever, but surprises us in some way. And then that drives the ideation phase, and you want to get a lot of ideas. Then you get feedback on, then you sketch that out, you get feedback on that. You go back and do some more observation again. And so we went through this whole thing at least once with at least one iteration of this plus another iteration of this one here in only 1 hour. And it's a very effective use of 1 hour to have achieved more than you probably would have been able to achieve if you just sat in a room by yourself saying, oh, I got to come up with an idea for a wallet. I got to come up with an idea for a wallet. Good luck coming up with an idea for a wallet. And this is just without even taking full advantage of design thinking, because we didn't use teams. And we didn't take advantage of this creative space to recombine information. So what I want to do now is kind of go back through this process and talk through how this might happen, not in some kind of like, you know, fake little 1 hour exercise in a class, but how you might use this for a real company of some sort. So I think I've got about a half an hour. I could easily talk, like I can easily do a whole semester on this, but I'm going to try to get through this pretty quickly. I think Cleo said that she was going to make these slides available for you. So I'm probably going to go through these a little bit faster than maybe you might want. So here's the design thinking process again. I'm going to use the Strashek Center one just because I think this is a little bit, I like this one better, partially because it uses the synthesizing rather than just a point of view. And I'm actually going to expand it as well and add team vision to this. And I'm going to add a business model phase to this thing as well too. So in this first phase, what you're doing is, so let's say, for example, we're trying to, I'll give you an example. Let's see. Okay, so we did a project in Munich where a company that makes coat hangers contracted with our university to design a coat hanger. We thought, okay, that's cool. Our students can design a new coat hanger. Sounds like a fun project, no problem. So we got started on this and we realized the company that contracted with us had 5,000 patents related to coat hangers. And we thought, oh my God, we're so screwed. How are my students possibly going to come up with a new idea that this company with 5,000 patents hadn't already come up with? And we're thinking, okay, trust the process, get out there and do something. So, of course, they went through the first thing is like, you know, the idea was, you know, go out there and try to understand the coat hanger market. Go out there and understand the coat hanger industry. You know, find out what's already out there, find out who's buying coat hangers, figure out the industry language, try to become mini experts in this coat hanger thing. Another phase tends to be reframing the challenge based on the values of your team. So, for example, you could say, well, we want to come up with a new coat hanger. Or you might reframe that to say, we want to come up with a new company that makes coat hangers. Or you might want to say, we want to come up with a new idea for a service industry that takes advantage of coat hangers. Maybe we want to be in the coat hanger service industry. Or maybe it's like, look, we just want to get through this class with a good grade. We really don't give a damn about coat hangers or starting up a new business or anything. But the team has to kind of sort of figure out, like, why are we doing this at all? Because this is what provides you energy for the rest of the semester as you go through it. It's not just like, oh man, Professor Gedeon screwed us. Like, he's making money from this company, and we're his, like, you know, little servants running around making money for them. Like, that's just not on. Like, what are the students selfishly getting out of this project? That's an example of reframing the thing. And one way to do that would be you can brainstorm a variety of things, you know, write it up on post-its, combine and separate it, pick the ones you like using dots on these post-its, and then coming up with your challenge. Next thing you want to do is get out of the building and start observing. So what happened was students went out and they started asking people questions. Tell me how you use coat hangers. And people told them things like, well, you know, I hang my coat on it, I hang my shirt on it, I hang up my pants on it, you know, I do this. What else do you do with your clothes? Well, I wash them, I iron them, I dry them, I put them in the hamper. And you're like, wow, we're learning nothing. We're learning absolutely nothing. We went out, we observed people, but people basically lied to us. They told us what we thought we wanted to hear. We're like, well, but we're trying to develop empathy with these people. But you can't develop empathy with people when you're talking to them on the street. We're trying to collect compelling stories, but we're like, wow. Like, I'm asking people, tell me about what you do with your clothes, and I couldn't get any compelling stories. We're like, aha, we need to observe in a different way. Don't just ask people what they do with their clothes. Go into their homes and find out. Call your buddy up and say, Megan, long time no see, haven't seen you in a long time. Can I come over with the six pack and maybe we can catch up on things? Yeah, sure, why not? Come on over. Great, Megan goes to the bathroom. Click, 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 click. Caught her in the act. What does she really do with her clothes? Oops, that's the wrong thing. Oh, sorry, I'm backing up here. So first of all, don't assume you know everything about the clothes hanger market. You need this beginner's mind, you know. Don't assume you know everything. Like, we know a little bit about icebergs, right? We know that most of it's below the surface, but actually, it's quite surprising when you really get out there and observe things. And you want this beginner's mind. So don't assume you know everything about the clothes hanger business. Anyway, so here's what we found out. So we started taking pictures. And we started seeing people doing this stuff with their clothes. Does this look familiar to anybody? Uh-huh. If you ask people what they do with their clothes, they don't tell you I throw them in a big heap. They tell you, well, I put them in the clothes hamper, and then I wash them, and then I dry them. Like, you don't learn anything from just asking people about stuff. You got to get out there and catch them in the act. You got to get out there and actually go into their homes and find stuff out. One of my favorite things to do is you get people when they can't get away. So if you go talk to them on the street, they're like, yeah, yeah, this is what I do with my clothes. But you catch them when they're on a bike thing here. You can walk right up to them and go, oh, you got 23 more minutes, huh? Can I ask you some questions? And they're stuck there for 23 minutes and they can't get away. That's one of my favorite ones. Try not to get thrown in jail over it. Try to get really good quotes. You're trying to develop an empathetic connection with people. You're trying to kind of get into their headspace to say, I can peer into your soul. I know what your needs are better than you know what your needs are because I've really kind of gotten into your headspace. And you can't do that when you're thinking about, I'm selling to doctors. Like, you have to have a particular doctor, or like, I'm selling to men. That's different than I'm selling to you, and I'm getting into your headspace, I'm developing an empathetic connection for what your needs are, and then hopefully there's lots of other people just like you. But I'm building it for you, not for 20-year-old guys. Because 20-year-old guys have a lot of differences. In fact, there might be more differences between the two of you than there are between the two of us. Just because you happen to be both guys and both around the same age doesn't necessarily mean that you're identical in the terms of the way that you deal with your clothes, for example. Look for workarounds. Here was an interesting thing. You know, we hadn't thought about this at first, but you know why you would do something like this? Why would you hang your sweater up like this to dry? Because if you hang it on a clothes hanger, what happens? You get the little things going on, right? Yeah, right. So, I mean, nobody on the street told us, you know what I hate about clothes hangers? I hated the fact that when I dry my big sweaters with the clothes hanger that they get the little wing things going on. Nobody told us that. You had to go into people's houses and look for these workarounds and go, oh yeah, that's a real problem. And now that you've pointed out that problem, now everybody's like, oh yeah, I got that problem too. Oh yeah, I have to lay my sweaters down. It's a real problem. But you don't discover this stuff when you're just kind of assume you know everything about coat hangers. You don't discover this stuff when you're only talking to people. You have to kind of like observe them in a deep way and kind of catch them in the act of things. Here's some tips on how to conduct interviews. Ask open-ended questions. Ask why a lot. Wow, this is really loud sometimes. Here we go. Ask the questions neutrally. Don't say, you know, so is it true that you don't lead the witness, right? So do you really find it annoying when you have to dry your sweaters and you get like, no. Don't ask questions like that. You're just trying to solicit feedback. If someone's telling stories, shut up and listen to them. You get some of the best stories when you just let people ramble. We did a project here at Ryerson for First Ontario. They're a credit union. And we were trying to design a new credit union. Actually, what they wanted us to do, their challenge was design a better credit union experience. When the students reframed that question, some of them said, actually, we don't really give a darn about First Ontario. We want to go into competition with First Ontario. Or some people said, we want to start up a new business that First Ontario will pay us money to deliver a service to them. Or some people said, actually, you know, we hate all you banks. We want to put you out of business. We want to find a way to disintermediate you big, fat, bloated organizations that do so little of value. I backed up two steps and talked to you about the reframing the question. But some of the stories we heard about the banks were incredible. People told us the worst stories about how they hated their banks. Dirty, rotten bastards. Did you change banks? No. What is going on? You hate your bank. I hate my bank. Why don't you change? Well, you know, and then you... So you got to listen to these things. And you're trying to find extreme cases because, you know, remember when we went through the paper wallet exercise, the more divergent ideas you've got, the better you can kind of explore the design space and say, aha, I'm going to take an idea from this and I'm going to take an idea from this. I'm going to take an idea from here and put it together in an unusual way that wouldn't have been obvious to the average person. You're trying to come up with new ways to delight people. Don't be afraid of silence. Like if you ask somebody a question and they don't answer right away, just shut up. Because they're probably wondering whether they should tell you something or not. Well, I'm thinking about disclosing something actually kind of sort of embarrassing. And if you just shut up long enough, they'll tell you. Rather than, you know, you ask them a question, if they don't answer right away, well, you keep talking again. Well, you didn't learn anything. So these are some powerful interviewing techniques. Watch for body language and inconsistencies. It's really nice to go out with a pair of people and you ask somebody a question. And like, you know, I'm totally engaged with you and your partner in the meantime is sitting there going, yeah, she's lying. She said that, but she doesn't mean that at all. Like, really? Yeah. Did you see her body language? Did you see how she went like this? And she's like, oh, well, you know. It's like, aha, you know, look for that kind of signals because you're trying to uncover things that aren't obvious. Take a lot of notes, take a lot of pictures, partially because, again, think about this. You've interviewed, let's say there's five people in your team. You interview 10 people each. That's 50 people you've interviewed. That's more than the human brain is capable of remembering. So you need ways to remember these things by taking pictures, getting extreme stories, things that help you remember this. And now imagine that you're in a company that you've been, imagine you're Microsoft, for example. You're not just interviewing 50 people. You might be interviewing 5,000 people. Like, how do you track 5,000 different interviews? So you need to track all that stuff. Don't forget to say thank you at the end. You know, here's kind of sort of the average way you go through an interview. You know, introduce yourself in the project, build rapport. But eventually you want to be getting these stories. And again, you're trying to get an emotional connection to people. Because very often people buy things based on emotions. And that's a very powerful way to understand the motivations of people and to build products that really delight them as opposed to like, you know, you build a wallet, but there's really no emotional connection to it as opposed to it's the perfect wallet that's, you know, I'm not gonna use an example. Take lots of pictures so you can remember things. This is an example of how you would share this kind of stuff out. Having a creative space like this is important so you can put all your stuff up all over the place and rearrange it. People remember stories really well, so share stories if you can. So you've done your divergent thinking. You've gone out and gotten a lot of information from a lot of different people. Now you need to condense that down. You need to turn that into, in the paper wallet exercise, we called it a point of view, was the thing that we used. This is kind of like the single question that you use to generate the ideation. Again, we haven't gotten to the ideation stage yet. I mean, the big lie of entrepreneurship is it starts with an idea. No, it doesn't start with an idea. It starts with the customer. It starts with the customer need. And it doesn't start with 1,000 customers. It starts with one customer that you have deep insights into something that that person will be excited and compelled to be involved in. So we're trying to make sense of the data in cluster observations and then differentiate between clusters of things. So again, this is where this idea of getting your information out onto a whiteboard with lots of post-it notes that you can move around, you can recombine, and I'm going to give you some examples. So here's an example that we're getting back to the coat hanger story again. So we went through and we got a variety of insights, and from those insights we picked three specific opportunities. And here's one way we did that. One way we did that was we did what this is called it's like a customer journey map is what the title of this thing is. A lot of these tools are there's a variety of places you can get this. There's a reasonably good book called Value Proposition Design. It's like version 2 of the Osterwalder's Business Model Canvas book. Osterwalder, the first one was Business Model Generation. The new companion piece is called Value Proposition Design. Has a lot of these tools. The Stanford D-School website has a lot of these tools. This is the tool called a customer journey map. In this case, the customer is the journey of the shirt. So, you wash your shirt, you dry it, you iron it, you store it, you move it, you wear it. Maybe you move it to a second home. Maybe you store it in a different place. You get home and you kind of go, it's not so bad. And you put it in a place to air out. But all those other people that we did, we had tons of observations on this. And I didn't know this about myself. My wife and I both do this. I had no idea. We both have our little air out spots. We get home like, it's not so bad. I'm gonna exercise in this shirt tomorrow. I'm not gonna throw it in the clothes hamper yet. I'm gonna wear it to exercise in tomorrow morning. And these post-its are the number of observations we had. So we had a few observations about moving it. We had a few observations, but we had a ton of observations around this interim storage. Like, how do you store a suit in your office? How do you store gym clothes? How do you store a spare set of clothes at your girlfriend or boyfriend's house or your friend's place? Storage in the back of your car, for example. We had a ton of these observations. We had a ton of observations around, there's something going on in this whole airing out thing. There's something we can do. There's some kind of a solution that the people with 5,000 patents around clothes hangers never thought of. For the people like so many of us in this room that have you kind of want to rewear your clothes if you can. I see you still looking at me like, dude, you're disgusting. here's another example. We did a project for Deutsche Bahn, and they said we want to make the train riding experience better. But what we did is rather than just looking at just the train ride experience, because fixing a train is really expensive, we looked at the whole journey from learning about your travel to planning it, starting it, getting your ticket, waiting, boarding, riding, da da da. And what we found when we did this and looked at the observations is we found one of the biggest pain points around here wasn't actually about the riding on the train. One of the biggest problems was around the waiting for the train. And if you think about this, how many people go through Union Station every day to get home? Or Union Station every once in a while to get home? Couple of people, boy, not many. Boy, this was a real shocker for me. Talk about barbaric. My God, I'm waiting for my train to come. And you all have to stand around in this hideous, ugly area that's cold, looking at a screen. I'm thinking, oh my God, it's the same train coming to the exact same place, to go to the exact same place every freaking day. Why do I have to stand here for a half an hour in the most miserable place in the entire subway system, waiting for it to go, track 3 in 3 minutes. Run like hell to track 3. Quick, get out of my way. My wife's disabled. Good frickin' luck making it from here to there in 3 minutes. Now imagine you're a tourist, or you don't speak English, or you don't know what the word track means. My God, it's painful. And every single person has to experience this. So if you plot like pain points, waiting was a big one. Continuing on was a big pain point as well, too. You get to your destination, you're like, okay, now what do I do? I'm in Regensburg. I could go to Glustermeister Vergerweg, or I could go to Blurber Zerber Strasse. Like, I don't have a freaking clue what to do. And it's dark, and it's kind of dangerous, and women hated this, dark, late at night. So these are real pain points. We looked at the cost of fixing things, and if you map these two things together, you tell me what you want to fix. Waiting was a big pain point, doesn't cost a lot of money. Let's do that one first. Continuing on, big pain point doesn't cost a lot of money to fix. Let's do that one. So for the continuing on thing, like add some lights, have a little bit of music, and maybe some better wayfinding things. And maybe a big sign with a button, you know, in case of emergency, press here, and people felt safer, especially single women riding late at night. It was a real easy fix for a really big pain point, as opposed to, you know, we could rip out every seat in the entire 50,000 train system in the entire, you know, European continent because we want to make the seats a quarter of an inch wider for the, good luck with that. So that's an example of a synthesis tool called the customer journey. Another synthesis tool you can use to cluster your observations is an idea of a 2x2 matrix. So you can plot anything against anything. You could plot ease of implementing a solution versus how fast you can do it. You could plot how realistic it is to do versus how big of a pain point it might be. You could plot whether we as a team give a darn about this versus whether the customer cares about this kind of thing. Do we have the capacity to do it, you know, versus is this something that we're passionate about? And you can plot any two things, but it's a way to cluster your observations and then maybe do a dotmocracy thing where each person gets a little, maybe three dots, and you get to kind of sort of vote on the things you want. And most people usually vote on stuff up here. But it's a screening tool to take a lot of observations down to what's our challenge going to be. Finally, we can start generating ideas. Wow, but I thought entrepreneurship was all about coming up with ideas. You know, you're in your bathroom like, boing, I got this great idea. I've got a great idea. Don't tell anybody your great idea. Your idea probably sucks. This is a way to get better ideas, more ideas, and ideas based on real needs rather than an idea that just kind of pops into your head in the bathroom in the middle of the night and you have no idea. It's the first idea you've had, so you think it's the best idea you've ever had. Sorry, maybe I've been teaching too long. There's lots of creativity tools here, like brainstorming is a very well-known thing. Go to Google, type in brainstorming, you'll get 1,000 things. The basic idea is you want to come up with, again, you're doing divergent thinking now. Observation was a divergent thinking thing. Synthesis, point of view, were techniques to get down to a specific sentence. You know, like Daniel needs a way to go out and organize his stuff, but the problem is that, you know, he hates to carry anything more than, you know, weighs 2 ounces or something because, you know, he...
Precise.
Yeah, precise. There we go. I got it right. I know you. You know, you want wild ideas. You're looking for divergent thinking. Every idea is good. Quantity is more important. Every person should have an idea. You want to build on other people's ideas. These are standard things. Draw is a better way. It uses the left side of uses the right side of the brain instead of the left side of the brain. So drawing things is better than writing them out. Then you can select your ideas using these 2x2 screening tools again. Then you want to do this rapid prototyping idea. And I think this is a huge failure that a lot of people have, is they want to go right to, now I got to hire somebody to build my beautiful app. Most people want to go right from their idea to building some kind of a product. And that's usually very, very, very expensive. And whatever your idea is, it's probably wrong. So first of all, don't have one idea, have 50 ideas. And then don't build one, build all 50 of them, or build the first 5. But you don't have to build the whole thing. You can get more feedback from your customers with a story, or role playing, or a sales presentation, or my favorite is slideware. Like, just go talk to a customer and say, this is what we're going to build for you. You know, I mean, we've got a project right now we're doing with one of my courses. We've got 12 different patented technologies that we're helping commercialize. It's about 50 different patents, about 10 million of money has gone into these things. One is like a real-time mass spectrometer for measuring like impurities in beer. The last thing that my students are gonna do is go to a beer brewery with like this $250,000 gizmo and say, hey, you want to look at my big gizmo? So actually, you don't need the freaking gizmo. You can't show them the gizmo anyway. The only thing they're going to look at is a PowerPoint presentation. You didn't actually have to build the gizmo to find out whether the breweries care about impurities in their beer. You could have had that meeting long before you spent $500,000 to build the gizmo. Kind of surprising, because the engineers, they want to build the gizmo. But I need to know if I can figure out how to do it. Eh, you're smart people. I'm sure you can figure out a way to make it work. But does anybody actually need it? Is the more important question. And very often, you can get way better feedback and information on emails. You know, do people care more about the real-time mass spec isn't a good idea. I don't know. Let's go back to this paper wallet idea. Do people care more about portability of their purse, or do they care about size, or do they care about customizability? Well, I'm not sure. Why don't we get a group of 50 women at random, and we'll send emails to the first 20 promoting customizability, and we'll send another 20 to a different group of women promoting portability, and we'll send a brochure or an email promoting affordability to another 20 people, and we see how many people click on the button. See how many people hit reply. See how many people unsubscribe. That's a test. Hey, people care more about portability than they care about customizability. And you can learn that without having to build three different purses. So there's a lot of stuff that you can do without having to go to the trouble and the time and the expense and the time, because we're trying to get to version 3. We're trying to live long enough to get to version 3. You can go through the first 5 or 6 versions before you've even hired an engineer. I don't even know if I can make this crazy thing yet, and I've already found out, I've gone through 5 iterations of PowerPoint slides to figure out if anybody even cares if I can figure out how to make this thing. Anyway, so this is what we mean by rapid prototyping. The best way to experience an experience is to experience it. Try to make it as realistic as possible, but you don't have to spend a lot of time and money on this. And you don't have to hire engineers. Like, build cheap and easy prototypes. You know, here's an example of a light that we had created for one project. This is my favorite one. We did this one for First Ontario. We were looking at the idea of an interactive ATM. So, you know, you go up to the ATM, and right now there's no person on the other side. And we said, let's prototype an ATM where if you push the big red button, somebody comes up on the screen. And that's how we prototyped it. And we got to find out, like, do people like that or do people not like that? And it turned out some of their customers, especially those crazy old people over 40, they love this kind of stuff. And we did all the prototyping here to find out, like, how many people liked it, how many people pushed on the emergency button. It's kind of cool. We didn't have to have a camera. That's all it was. You can have higher resolution prototypes. You know, we can make wireframes to get stuff. You know, anytime you ever meet with somebody, anything, like, bring a prototype with you and get feedback on it. Anytime you ever go to a meeting, get feedback on something. Business model canvas is kind of like a prototype as well too. I don't want to spend time covering that. Don't fall in love with your prototypes. Don't fall in love with, what was the thing before the iPad that Steve Jobs invented? The Newton. Don't fall in love with your Newton. Don't try to tell people how great your Newton is. It's just a prototype. If you try to sell at people, you don't get honest feedback. So, you know, regardless of whether it's version 1 or 2 or 3 or 4, don't fall in love. It's all about being on that motorcycle and generating as many iterations and learning as you can. Don't try to sell your ideas, you're just trying to get feedback. I'll give you one example here of a company came to me and they were selling IT telephony solutions, basically your telephone through a computer. It was like a computer system to run your company's telephone system. And the product sold for $50, and they were making about 2,000 euros a month. And I said, well, I don't know the first thing about your business. I've never bought any one of these things. I'm not even sure what half of the words mean, and half the conversation was in German, so I wasn't even sure what they were saying half the time. But I said, one thing I'm certain of is your price is wrong. Well, why do you think it's wrong? I'm like, I don't know. Why do you think it's right? Well, it's been 50 euros for 2 years and people are buying. I'm like, yeah, well, if you increase the price, would they buy more? Well, why would they buy more? I'm like, I don't know. Would they buy more if you charge less? Well, I'm not sure. Exactly, you don't know. So let's come up with a prototype. Let's come up with a new product at twice the price. Oh, we don't have time for a new product. I said, well, let's come up with a new fake product. Throw in, it's the same product as the other product for 50 euros, but let's throw in an hour of free tech support. The 50 euro product comes with unlimited free tech support anyway. So I said, does anybody actually know that? Probably not. Well, let's come up with this afternoon. Go back to the website and have a 100 euro product, which is the same as the 50 euro product, and gives an hour of free tech support. And if people get really mad at you and they accuse you of being horrible people, we'll just take it down really quickly. So they did this, and after a week, they discovered 95% of the people clicked on the 100 euro button instead of the 50 euro button. Ah, let's come up with a 200 euro price point for, I don't know, 3 hours of free tech support. 95% of the people clicked on the 200 euro price point. We kept doing this. We never redid the product. There was not a single moment of engineering time that went into any of these things. And the revenue into the company had already quadrupled by just changing the price point as a prototype, as an experiment for a week. Well, after 4 or 5 iterations of this, we tried a free one. That didn't work so well. Nobody wanted the free one. What the hell's going on here? Now we need the Dom Perignon version, right? Anytime you go into a restaurant, last page of the wine list, bottom right corner, this is the bottle that's too stupid for people with money. Like, if you're dumb enough to want to buy a $10,000 bottle of whatever, we'll gladly take your money because you're too stupid for money. The Dom Perignon price, 10,000 euros. Same product as the 50 euro thing. 28% of the people clicked on the 10,000 euro thing rather than the other one. Now she's giving me 2 minutes. Don't fall in love with your price point. It's almost certainly wrong. You just don't know if it's too high or it's too low. This company went from 2,000 a month to 50,000 a month in 1 month without changing one line of code. You think they'd name their kid after me? I got a bottle of scotch. Okay, so I've gone through the design thinking process, the extended one. This is kind of, you know, design thinking is this early stage thing. One of the limitations is it doesn't tell you what you should work on. You got to come up with that on your own. Speed comes from stability. There we go. Go get them. Thank you very much for your time. Appreciate it. Have a great night.